Hello, my name is Officer Ali Muhammad of the Community Outreach Unit with the Cranford Police Department. Today I'm here with Detective Ryan Gerrity of our Adult Detective Bureau. We wanted to share a little information about something that has been affecting our town of Cranford and towns all across the state, elder fraud. Elder fraud can affect all of us. We may have aging parents or other relatives who have become victims. We also may have loved ones, colleagues, friends, or neighbors who show signs of diminished mental capacity to know when they're being exploited. Fraud does not discriminate on who it affects. It might not have happened to you, but it's up to our community to share this information so it doesn't happen to the next person. So a little bit about elder fraud. Seniors age 60 and older account for about 15% of the population in the United States. And according to some estimates, seniors comprise 30% of fraud victims. So why are the elderly in particular vulnerable to financial fraud? And why is this problem likely getting worse? Well, there's a few factors. Seniors can be perceived as vulnerable, which can result from being health related. Aging can bring about mental and physical changes that heighten the risk of elder fraud. Some seniors are very trusting. Seniors tend to want to help those in need. They sometimes lack the awareness of someone willing to take advantage of them. Older people often believe in the pitches they hear. Some factors are related to financial and retirement trends. A large amount of the financial responsibility has shifted to that of the elderly. So now they're tasked with handling their own retirement savings and investments. And some seniors are often reluctant to seek advice about financial matters. The elderly are often trying to show their independence to their spouses, their children, or their friends. So when they're targeted, they most oftentimes feel embarrassed and don't share their worries to those closest to them. Detective Gerrity, thank you for joining us today. Why don't you go over a couple of scams that we've been having?
Of course. Thank you, Officer Mohammed, for having me. My name is Detective Gerrity. I'm part of the Investigative Division at Cranford Police Department. I'm going to go over some of the most common scams that we have. I'll start with the romance scam. It's exactly what it sounds like. Criminals pose as interested romantic partners on social media or dating websites to capitalize on elderly victims' desire to find companions when they really just want money. Another one would be a technical support scam. Criminals pose as technology support representatives, calling and offering to fix non-existent computer issues. My best advice here is if you don't have a computer or have not contacted a computer repair business, hang up the phone. The scammers gain remote access to victims' devices and sensitive information, and that allows them to get into bank accounts and take money. The third one would be grandparent scam, and criminals can pose as a relative, a lawyer, a police officer, and demand money when it comes to bail money for an arrest that didn't really happen. And then there's also government and utilities impersonation scam. This is quite common in our area as well. Criminals pose as government employees from the IRS, from PSE&G, the gas company, and they threaten arrest or prosecute victims unless they agree to provide funds or other payments. There are safeguards in place to ensure the utilities cannot be shut off to the customer, and the IRS will never contact you directly over the phone. They utilize the mail. And a couple more that we have would be the sweepstakes charity lottery scam. Basically, the call that you get saying that you won a sum of money. Criminals claim to work for legitimate charitable organizations as well to gain victims' trust, or to claim their targets have won a foreign lottery or a sweepstake, which they can collect for a fee. If it seems too good to be true, it most likely is. The home repair scam, criminals will appear in person and they'll offer home improvement services for money up front. Never provide them with money before any services are done. And you can also call our agency to validate their legitimacy in the town. TV radio scam. Criminals target potential victims using illegitimate advertisements about legitimate services, such as reverse mortgages or credit repair. And finally, family or caregiver scam. This is when it comes from internal issues. Relatives or acquaintances of elderly victims take advantage of them to get their money, and that's unfortunate.
So now we're just going to go over a few reports that we've had in town lately. This is one of our investigative reports that we've had over the last couple months. So the victim stated she received a three-way phone call from someone who claimed to be her granddaughter and a lawyer named Murray, who works for Schwartz Law Firm in Montreal. Murray stated that the granddaughter had been in a car accident in which she struck a pedestrian and she needed $9,500 to pay for the damages. The suspect on the phone advised the victim to withdraw $9,500 in cash from her bank account and place it in a white envelope titled United States Bonds Case File 3474 on the front. The suspect then stated to place the envelope in her mailbox and a courier will arrive shortly after picking up the money. All directions were followed and the suspect retrieved the envelope from the mailbox. Shortly thereafter, another phone call was made to the victim by the suspect stated that they needed an additional $1,900. The victim stated the bank was closed and that they would do that tomorrow. Later in the evening, the victim was able to contact her granddaughter and she stated that this was definitely a fraud call. So, Detective Gerrity, how would you have handled the situation if you were the victim?
That's a good question. I've investigated a couple of these before, and if I were the victim, the best thing you can do is hang up the phone and call that family member directly. If someone calls you from a strange number and states anything regarding a family member, whether it's a bail that needs to be met, or if they're stuck somewhere and they need money to get out, call that family member and confirm it. Don't take the strange number and the male or female on the other line's word for it. You'll never be asked to provide bail in any way of cash being picked up from your home. So that's been a very common thing. They'll require you to put cash in a shoebox or an envelope and put it on your front step and someone will come and retrieve it. Never do that. That is never going to be legitimate. If you can't immediately contact your family member, continue to try to do so, or call the police department in which they're saying your family member is located. We work with these cases all the time and we'll help confirm that your family member is not in our custody, and we can also help you through the situation.
Amazing. Again, I have another example here, another report that was taken within the past couple of months. So here we have a victim that stated she received a call from a male named Mark, who stated he was a representative of Apple. The suspect stated he would send her a new phone, but the victim would have to send $100. He requested that the payment be made with an iTunes gift card. The victim purchased this gift card and called the suspect back with the gift card number. The suspect stated that the gift card did not work and instructed the victim to purchase another gift card. The victim complied with the request and provided the suspect with the gift card information in the amount of $100. The suspect continued to manipulate the victim into purchasing 16 gift cards totaling $1,800. All these card numbers were provided to the suspect over the phone. Again, Detective Gerrity, how would you have handled this situation if you were the victim?
Now, listening to what Officer Muhammad just said, you may think that's ridiculous. Why would you ever buy gift cards to pay someone? This happens very often. Payment will never be requested in the form of gift cards from a legitimate business or agency, never. When a scammer asks you to buy iTunes gift cards or any type of gift card to pay them with, it's because it's an untraceable form of payment. Again, if you feel something is wrong, it doesn't make sense, hang up and call your local police department. Our officers, detectives, deal with these situations every day and be more than happy to help you and assist you through this. So a couple stats, just so you understand the numbers. In 2019 and 2020, the FBI recorded over 470,000 complaints when it comes to elder fraud. And in 2020, they recorded over 500,000 complaints. This equated to more than $3.5 billion in losses to individuals and to businesses.
The costliest scams involve businesses, email compromise, romance or confidence fraud, and mimicking the account of a person or a vendor known to the victim to gather personal or financial information. So these criminals are getting very sophisticated. It's getting harder and harder for victims to spot the red flags and tell the real from the fake. And that's coming from an FBI agent.
Now, when it comes to a couple of the scams, the hostage hoax, it can be called, or a bail phone scam, there's a couple tips I just want to go over. And on the PowerPoint here, you see, don't say your loved one's name. The reason I say that is if you use the name first, they're going to key in on that name and make it more believable. Let the scammer use your family member's name to first determine whether they even have that information. In some instances, they do have the information. And when it comes to that, you can ask them questions that they may only know. For example, color of their bedroom walls, the family pet's name, the birth date of a grandparent, a birth date of a parent. They may threaten you to not call the victim directly because they'll cause them harm if you do. This is a tactic to keep you from contacting the person they're claiming to have kidnapped because it would end the entire hoax. If the kidnapper states that they're in a certain area, you can call the jurisdiction where they may be and find out if there's been calls for any sort of kidnapping or anything like that, or call your local police agency and confirm that no one is being kidnapped and that your family member is safe. Scammers are trying to get any amount of money from you as quickly as they can. If you hesitate, they'll likely lower the amount they're asking in an attempt to get a quick payout and hang up. Further with this, you can use a third-party tracking app. This is very effective for children and parents. You can see where your child is on a map. They have a phone on them and it shows a GPS location of where your child is. So if a scammer calls and says they have your child, you can reference your phone to know that's not the case. Scammers go to great lengths to keep you on the phone and try to prevent you from calling or locating the kidnapped victim. Some people that are victim to this scam, once they figure it out, they may find it amusing to engage with the scammer or call them back. Don't call randomly missed phone numbers back and don't play with the scammer. These both encourage the scammer to continue to call you and ultimately just harass you. Our police department, our county, state, and federal partners are best trained and situated to handle true missing persons and fraud investigations, not these so-called kidnappers or hoaxmen.
So be aware of fake invoices or suspicious mail, okay? Be sure to check those email addresses. The name may be familiar, but the email address may be a long string of unrelated characters that have nothing to do with the actual address. Some scams may have an email that's one letter off, a couple letters off, and more often times than not, they use the ending and they change it. So instead of putting .net, they'll use .com or vice versa. So again, we have another investigative report that we've taken in the last couple of months. This one, the victim states that they were contacted over the phone by suspect David Young. The suspect claimed to be a social security officer and claimed that the victim's DNA via a blood sample was found in a car rental in Texas. The suspect advised the victim to empty all of her bank accounts down to $100 and advised him when that was done. The victim became suspicious over the phone, where the suspect transferred her to a Sam Bolt who claimed to be a Social Security Department supervisor. So now we're getting into that multi-tier, you know, scam. This second suspect confirmed the original orders, and he additionally stated that she would be charged with drug trafficking and money laundering if she did not apply. So again, Detective Gerrity, in this situation, what would you do? What would you advise this victim?
The first red flag here is the Social Security Administration will rarely ever contact you by phone. Unless you've already been in contact with them prior to this call, they're only going to utilize mail services. Anyone claiming to be a Social Security officer via phone is most likely a scammer. The tactic of transferring you to another person, as in this case was Sam Bolt, is to make it more believable that there is a supervisor that you can speak to. This is not the case. When they call you, they're going to call and demand immediate payment. They're going to call and demand that you pay a debt without the ability to appeal the amount owed, and that's not the case. Social Security Administration will never do that. They're going to require a specific means of payment, such as requiring you to pay with a prepaid debit card, cash, gift cards. We've already been over that. That's not legitimate. Ask for your personal information or credit and debit card numbers is very common from the scammer. Never give any information over the phone. And they're going to threaten you with arrest or deportation to get that fear in you to comply.
So scammers will pretend to be from institutions that you're definitely familiar with. You've probably received these emails or phone calls. Someone reaches out to you claiming to be from the IRS, the Social Security Administration, or another government organization. The caller says you owe money and you must pay, or legal action will be taken. The email may have official logos or your caller ID, that may reflect the government agency's name. So these usually come from the form of emails, phone calls. The IRS will never make first contact via a phone call and claim that you owe them money. Again, I want to reiterate, you'll receive a letter with details and steps you can take. If you just receive a call, simply hang up the phone. Please do not engage with the caller. Someone may threaten or become abusive. If you settle and pay over the phone, expect repeated phone calls to be made as discrepancies are later found. In other words, they will extract as much cash from you as you will allow them to. Scammers will usually tell you how to pay. They often insist that you pay by sending money through a money transfer company or by putting money on a gift card and then giving them the number on the back of that gift card. Others will send you a check that you will later turn out to be a fake check, and they'll tell you to deposit it, and then you send them the money for that check. That usually is a larger amount. There is never a utility company, government agency, bail company, computer repair company, or hostage situation that was rectified by the purchase of an Amazon gift card or an Apple gift card, okay? We gotta remember that. No one will request a gift card as payment if they're a legitimate company.
And overall, we want you to learn all this so you can protect yourself. That's our main concern here at Cranford Police Department. So you need to recognize these scam attempts and end all communication with the scammer. If you hang up the phone, they may call back. Don't pick up. If you're concerned, call your local agency and report it. An officer will come out to you, or you can come in person, report it, and we'll go through the different ideas and the different ways we can investigate the case. You need to resist the pressure to act quickly. Scammers create a sense of urgency to produce fear and lure victims into immediate action. Call the police immediately if you feel there's a danger to yourself or a loved one. And again, be cautious of unsolicited phone calls, mailings, and door-to-door service offers. And I can't say this enough. Never give or send any personal identifiable information, money, jewelry, gift cards, checks, or wire information to unverified people over the phone, in person, anything.
So I just want to go over a little bit of how you can report this. So if you believe you or someone you may know has been a victim of elder fraud or any type of fraud, contact your local police department. When you report this scam, regardless of the dollar amount, include as many of the following details as possible. So I have here listed names of the scammer or the company that they're saying they're from, the dates of the contact, you know, the methods of communication. So it can either be by phone number, email address, you know, those mailing addresses, or any website you use by the scammer, and also the method of payment. You have to know where you sent the funds, including wire transfers or prepaid cards, and you provide the financial institution names, account numbers, and account names, and description of your interaction with the scammer, whether it be in person or via the phone, and the instructions that you were given. Try to give as much information as possible. And this is just something I want everyone to note, that you can get a free credit report annually, okay? Everyone is eligible for one free credit report every year. So it's very smart to check what credit lines have been open or been unresolved. And it's a very easy way that you can quickly dispute any fraudulent activity. This is the most common way people can find out they've been frauded or someone has opened something in their name. So what I want you guys to do is really follow us on our social media page. Okay, you can find out the latest trends that have been going on with scamming. You can contact the police department whenever you feel that you've been frauded. We have a lot of different ways you can follow us on social media. We have Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. All that information is here. And Detective Gerrity, I want to thank you for coming on today's talk and really letting the people know and the community know that, you know, they're not alone and that this can really happen to anyone.
Absolutely. Thank you, Officer Muhammad, for having me on here. And please don't hesitate to call and report these incidents to us. Everyone here is more than willing to help and assist you through these very believable scams sometimes. Thank you again.
Again, for more information or any follow-up questions, you can reach me, Officer Mahami of the Community Outreach Unit, at 908-272-8989. And there's my email address right there. Again, thank you for tuning in and watching this. Hopefully this helps someone out there. Thank you.